Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's professional lunch at the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. I'm a former president of the club, Anthony Rowley, and I'm also acting as moderator today. And it's my pleasure to introduce today's guest on my right, Dr. Paul Sheard, who is Executive Vice President and Chief Economist of S&P Global. S&P Global, which I didn't know until today, it's not the holding company, it's the kind of the listed company, if you like, for what is now a very broad and diverse empire of S&P activities. Paul needs very little introduction because he's a frequent and always very welcome visitor and speaker at this club. He offered us a very wide menu of subjects on which he was prepared to speak today, ranging from the imminent issue of Britain's Brexit vote to the state of the Chinese economy, and not to mention the upcoming presidential election in the US. In the event, we opted to have Dr. Sheard talk about Abenomics, negative interest rates, and helicopter money, since those are issues even closer to home than Brexit. Our speaker is a man of very wide experience, however, and knowledge, and I'm sure he'll be happy to take questions on just about any of the topics that I've mentioned, as well as on his main themes. He heads the teams that produce the macroeconomic forecasts used by Standard & Poor's analysts during the ratings process, and he chairs the Standard & Poor's Academic Council. He also helps oversee the S&P Global Institute and is a member of the Standard & Poor's Executive Committee. Previous to that, Paul held many positions, eminent positions. He was chief economist at Nomura Securities and also at Lehman Brothers, and earlier was head of Japan Equity Investments and Japan strategist at Baring Asset Management in Tokyo. He speaks often at major conferences around the world, and his views are many times quoted in the international media. He was a member of the World Economic Forum Global Agenda Council on the International Monetary System. So I'm going to stop at that and give the floor to Dr. Sheard. Please switch off your mobile phones or put them onto manner mode, and please join me in welcoming our speaker.
Thank you very much, Anthony, and thank you for that warm welcome. And it is indeed a great pleasure to be back here at the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. And I'm always impressed how magically this podium manifests itself in front of my eyes. So without further ado, let me just get into the subject matter today, Abenomics, negative interest rates and helicopter money, and then the question of are policymakers out of ammunition. So let me start with Abenomics, which I've spoken about on several occasions at this podium. So I'll sort of give you a very abbreviated view. I won't go into too much detail. But you know, Abenomics, of course, is a brilliant marketing word to have a branch of economics named after you. But of course, it really refers to the economic policies of the Abe administration, which is now, of course, about 3.5 years old. I would highlight really two aspects of Abenomics. One is, rather than talk about the three arrows per se, the first one is the idea of using monetary and fiscal policy to end deflation. So if you like, the reflation agenda. And then the second aspect is, of course, the growth strategy, which is really about taking measures to try to improve Japan's long-run growth potential, real growth potential, which really, given that Japan has a shrinking population and a shrinking workforce, is more about arresting the inevitable decline in Japan's real potential growth, rather than raising it very much per se. I'm not really going to talk about that part of Abenomics. Let me just focus a little bit on the first part in particular and the significance of the reflation objective. And again, here I would sort of highlight two points. I call this a Copernican revolution at the Bank of Japan that happened when Mr. Kuroda took over from Mr. Shirakawa back in early 2013. Because what happened when the governorship changed at the Bank of Japan was the stated philosophy and the communication, the belief system of the central bank turned 180 degrees. from a situation under Governor Shirakawa where the communicated view of the Bank of Japan and certainly of the governor was that monetary policy was incapable of overcoming deflation. It could help, but it wasn't the primary tool that could end deflation and achieve inflation of 2%. But rather that deflation in Japan was driven by structural factors and particularly the declining population. Mr. Kuroda, on the other hand, is very much in the orthodoxy of central bankers that essentially says monetary policy and perhaps fiscal policy together can, if they are used correctly enough and for long enough, end a deflation. And we'll come to helicopter money a little bit later on as well. That has a part to play there. The second thing which was I think very important about the reflation agenda of Abenomics was the idea that fiscal policy was going to be, when it comes to the use of fiscal policy, ending deflation would be prioritized over fiscal consolidation, and this was a shift in Japanese macroeconomic policy, where it had always been the case that there was this sort of impulse to engage in early fiscal consolidation, but in an economy that was stuck in deflation, that of course made it much more difficult to end deflation. So that was at least the promise of Abenomics. Now, in the event, if we now look back over the last 3.5 years and say, well, how has that gone? The Bank of Japan comes in for a lot of criticism, I think, as we'll perhaps discuss in a moment with negative interest rates. But I would say the big policy error that was made in Japan was to push ahead with the consumption tax hike in April 2014. And that was really only about 1 year or a little bit more than 1 year, let's call it 1.25 years, into the Abenomics agenda. And that fiscal consolidation pushed the economy into recession. I don't have to go back and rerun that history too much, but in the 9 quarters since that consumption tax was hiked, 9 quarters of GDP that we now have, 4 of those quarters were negative growth quarters. And if you look at, for example, just interestingly, if you count from the first quarter of 2013 when Abenomics started to the first quarter of 2014, just before the consumption tax hike was raised, real GDP increased in that 5-quarter period by 3.4%. Since then, real GDP net-net is down 0.9%. So the first year or so of Abenomics was actually quite strong growth, and then in the period since then, real GDP growth net-net, there have been some up quarters and some down quarters, has been almost minus 1%. Now you might say, that's a little bit unfair because I'm counting the first quarter of 2014, the quarter before the consumption tax was hiked, and of course you had a lot of front-loading of consumption demand precisely because the consumption tax was hiked. So it's probably a fairer comparison to take that quarter out and just look at the first year of Abenomics to the end of fourth quarter 2013 and then what has happened to GDP since then. And if you do that calculation, in that first 4 quarters of Abenomics, real GDP increased by 2.1%, and in the 9 quarters since then, real GDP net-net has increased only by 0.4%. So really, I'm just giving you these figures really to give you a sense that I think when you look back on Abenomics to date, and particularly on the ending deflation side of the equation, that was really where the key policy error was made. My view is that it would have been better to have crafted Abenomics in a slightly different way, which would have been to say that the consumption tax hikes would be made dependent or conditional, not on policies being put in place which were expected to produce certain results, ending deflation in particular, but rather to make the implementation of the consumption tax hikes conditional on the Bank of Japan and the government having achieved its objective of ending deflation and securing 2% inflation. Why is that? Well, because it's much easier for a central bank to defend an inflation target that is it has achieved than to achieve that inflation target in the beginning from a position of entrenched deflation. So where are we today? Well, recently, of course, Prime Minister Abe made a historic decision to delay the second round of the consumption tax hike until October 2019. Of course, back in November 2014, he made the decision to delay the consumption tax hike that was expected in October of last year to April 2017. But in the event, that clock ticking down to the second stage of the consumption tax hike was ticking quite quickly, and April 2017 was approaching. So I think it was entirely an appropriate decision to say the focus here has to be on achieving an end to deflation and securing stable, low inflation of, say, around 2%, and hiking the consumption tax next year would just not have been helpful in that regard. It would actually have been quite damaging in that regard. So I think that was a good decision. And now, if you look at the macro policy mix, you have a central bank that is continuing to be extremely aggressive, mobilizing all kinds of policy tools, QQE and now negative interest rates, to end deflation, and fiscal policy, which is not at least going to get in the way of that. And that would be your classic macro policy mix that you would want in order to achieve that policy objective. Now, of course, ending deflation in and of itself, that's a good thing, but that is not going to do very much for Japan's potential growth, for its standard of living, etc. That really requires policies to be implemented that are directed at the real side of the economy, but nonetheless, it is certainly something that is well worth achieving. Now, let me talk a little bit about negative interest rates then. I talked last year in November of last year, and since then, of course, we've had this historic move by the Bank of Japan in January to implement negative interest rates. You know, you may have gathered, I'm a bit of a central bank watcher. I spend a lot of time watching the Bank of Japan. I spend a lot of time watching the ECB and the Fed these days as well. But one of the things that's going to be very interesting when historians look back on this period since the financial crisis, and even before the financial crisis, is the way in which central banks have been experimenting as they've gone deeper and deeper into uncharted territory. They've been experimenting with new kinds of policy tools and sort of, you know, copying each other and mimicking each other. Of course, the Bank of Japan pioneered quantitative easing after the financial crisis. The Bank of England, the Federal Reserve, eventually the ECB, all adopted quantitative easing. So the Bank of Japan was the pioneer there. But negative interest rates, when it came to negative interest rates, the pioneers were in Europe. And there are actually four, I think, latest count of major central banks there that are implementing negative interest rate policy. The most prominent one being the ECB, which announced that policy in June 2014, but you also have the Swedish Riksbank, the Swiss National Bank, and the Danish Central Bank, all with a negative interest rate. Now, I'm actually not a big fan of negative interest rates, and I'll come to that a little bit in a moment, but by the same token, it seems to me that a lot of the criticism that is directed, the furor directed at the Bank of Japan, also I think is a little bit misplaced. So economists what is this negative interest rate? How do we understand this? And that's one of the reasons why I'm not a great fan of negative interest rates, is that you really struggle to explain what it is to people. And if something is that mysterious, it may have some problems in terms of doing its job. Remember, economists used to talk about the zero bound. There's a whole literature in economics and central bank policy making about, you know, what happens when central banks hit the zero bound. Well, they cut the interest rate to zero, and that was presumed in the good old days, not many years ago now, to mean that central banks had no interest rate tools left. they could then do really two things. One was forward guidance, this idea of essentially using various communications to the marketplace to signal to the market that the interest rate would be kept at zero for an awful long time, and that would put downward pressure on the whole yield curve. So the idea that central banks, even if they hit the zero bound, they could push the yield curve down and lower interest rates out on the longer tenor. And of course, the other thing they could do was switch to quantitative easing and start buying a bucket load of assets and finance those asset purchases by creating excess reserves or central bank money. And one of the reasons that economists and policymakers assumed that there was a zero bound was this idea of the time value of money, what economists call time preference, which is simply the idea that, put it this way, you know, if I said to somebody in the audience, you know, could you please lend me, you know, $100, and next year I'll give you $95 back, I don't think I would find many takers. You would say, well, I'm not going to give you $100 and get $95 or $99 back next year, because that would be a negative interest rate. You just keep your $100. And what about a bank? If a bank said to you, please deposit your money with our bank, and we will charge you for that privilege. We'll charge you a negative interest rate. Now, if you had a lot of money and you derived actual value from the fact that, you know, you could safely deposit it in the bank rather than in your safety deposit box in your bedroom, you might be prepared to accept a certain amount of negative interest rate. But not very much, because you would probably just decide, particularly if you're a small depositor, you'd say, well, I just will keep that money under my bed. At least that way, I'll know that if I've got $100 today, I'll have $100 in a year's time, unless somebody stole it, rather than having a negative interest rate imposed. So economists always took the view that really negative interest rates would not really exist because of that time preference or that time value of money. So how is it that central banks are able to implement, they seemingly at will, a negative interest rate policy? Well, the reason for that is that central banks, unlike you or I, can actually control the amount of money that is deposited with them. In other words, the central bank, through its operations, including these days QE, is able essentially to determine the aggregate amount of reserves in the banking system. Reserves, or what are called current account deposits in Japan, being the deposits of financial institutions with the central bank. The central bank can't determine which, how much any individual central bank, any individual financial institution holds, because banks are free to lend those reserves or borrow those reserves. But they can determine the aggregate level of reserves. And in fact, that's why central banks can do quantitative easing. That is what quantitative easing is, the ability to expand the balance sheet at will by creating excess reserves and keeping those excess reserves in the system. So that's the sort of the dirty little secret of why you central banks can have a negative interest rate. They can do it because they get to determine the overall amount, and therefore, by definition, they can also control the price, and they can put a negative interest rate. So that's sort of why you got this negative interest rate policy. But what negative interest rates can't do is to force people in the real economy to lend at a negative interest rate. You know, don't worry, negative interest rates are not coming to your doorstep in that sense anytime soon. However, this negative interest rate policy of central banks can influence market interest rates. And one thing that we've observed in Japan, and we've observed this in Europe as well, is somewhat surprisingly, negative interest rate policy has led to the yield curve not just flattening, but actually going negative out to, in some cases, 10 years or even longer. So one of the things that perhaps has been a little bit surprising is this negative interest rate policy of the central banks has been quite effective in creating sort of negative interest rates in the traded bond market, which I don't think was something that people would necessarily have anticipated. So if you think about how monetary policy traditionally is supposed to work, primarily it is directed at domestic monetary conditions, that is, lowers interest rates and puts downward pressure across the entire yield curve. So in that regard, the Bank of Japan's policy surprisingly, appears to have worked quite well in terms of domestic monetary conditions. Now, the other thing I'd noticed about the Bank of Japan scheme is that it is actually quite clever. What the Bank of Japan said is, okay, we want to influence the yield curve. We want to be more aggressive with our monetary policy. So we want to impose a negative interest rate. However, imposing a negative interest rate on the banks, on their deposits, is a little bit like imposing a tax on the banking system. And of course, the Bank of Japan, through its QQE, has created an enormous amount of excess reserves in the banking system. So if the Bank of Japan had just applied a negative interest rate across the board, it would have been collecting quite a bit of money from the banking system. So what it said to itself is, well, if we want to influence the yield curve, all we really need to do is put a negative interest rate on the marginal reserves that we are creating in the banking system. We don't have to apply a negative interest rate to all of the inframarginal reserves. They don't influence the pricing of the yield curve. It's only sort of at the margin. And they've created this policy rate balance concept and essentially are saying, we're going to keep the amount of reserves on which we charge negative interest rates, I think it's 10 to 30 trillion yen. Now, 10 to 30 trillion yen sounds like a lot to you and me, but actually, in terms of the size of the banking system's balance sheet, in terms of the size of the Japanese economy, that's not very much. So in that sense, what strikes me, looking at all of this from my perch in New York, is that the scheme that the Bank of Japan came up with is sort of surprisingly kind of clever in terms of its conceptualization, and it actually seems to have worked well in terms of putting downward pressure on the domestic yield curve. That should mean that over time, of course, borrowing costs come down for general borrowers in the economy. Probably won't go negative, but they'll go down, and that should support economic activity. So that's perhaps a little bit more of a positive spin on what the Bank of Japan is doing than perhaps you would typically hear in this country. There seem to be two major criticisms, as far as I can tell, and I'd love to be educated by the audience on others, if there are others, of the Bank of Japan's negative interest rate policy. And by the way, it's a little bit kind of, I feel a little bit role reversal to be standing up here, in some sense, kind of defending the Bank of Japan, because I lived in Japan for 17 years, and particularly from 93 to 2006, was probably, for those of people who knew me, they would know me as a trenchant critic of the Bank of Japan. So it is a bit of a role reversal to be a little bit more complimentary. But there are two criticisms. One is the criticism that negative interest rates didn't work because the yen strengthened quite dramatically. If you remember, the yen was around about 120 to the dollar, a little bit weaker perhaps at the time of that January decision, and now the yen is around about 104, 105. And so it made a pretty big movement. And this certainly is a little bit of a puzzle. Again, I don't really know any good explanation of why the yen has strengthened. And I think the Bank of Japan's explanation seems to be, well, you know, and I would sort of agree with this to a large extent, we as a central bank don't target the exchange rate per se. That's not what we're trying to target, although monetary policy will affect the exchange rate. But the exchange rate is determined by a lot of things. Basically, when a currency is strengthening, it means that investors, both domestic and foreign, on balance, want to hold more of that currency. If it's weakening, it's because net-net investors want to actually hold less of that currency. So in a slightly kind of perverse kind of way, you could argue that the fact that if you believe that the yen strengthening is related to negative interest rate policy, it defies a little bit of logic because, you know, interest rates out to 10 years are negative in the bond market. Normally, that effect should put downward pressure on the exchange rate. So if the exchange rate has risen, notwithstanding that fact, then is that a vote of confidence in the Japanese economy? I don't know if anyone's making that argument. It seems a little bit counterintuitive, but that would be actually one sort of interpretation of what has gone on. But it could also be that there's a lot of stuff going on in the world. We have the Brexit vote on Thursday, for example, but we've had a lot of concerns about China. There's increasing concerns about the sustainability of the US economic recovery. There's concerns in emerging markets. And, you know, the yen is typically a safe haven currency. So, you know, it could be that we're just not able to observe the counterfactual, that is, negative interest rate policy, all other things equal, may actually be a force acting to weaken the yen, but it's being overpowered by a whole array of other forces which are causing that appetite for holding safe yen assets to pick up. But in any case, the point I'd really like to emphasize here is that I think altogether there's too much emphasis in interpreting or evaluating negative interest rate policy on the exchange rate and not enough focus on domestic monetary conditions, which is the yield curve, which really appears to have reacted quite favorably to negative interest rate policy in the sense that yields went down into negative territory. One of the things that economists will tell you about monetary policy is, and central bankers will tell you, is that monetary policy works with long and varying lags. That sounds like a little bit of a cop-out, but the idea is it takes quite a long time for the changes in the financial conditions that monetary policy creates to work their way into the real economy and influence real economic activity, which is the ultimate thing central banks are trying to influence. So I do, again, I've sort of felt, listening to some of the commentary around the Bank of Japan's negative interest rate policy, that it's a little bit premature to be deeming this policy a failure. I think we do need to give it more time to see, importantly, how the real economy responds to the lower funding costs. Now, one data point did catch my attention, which is the first quarter data on bank lending to real estate in Japan, which actually picked up 6.7% year on year. Overall bank lending is increasing at the moment about 2.3%, but the quarterly data on bank lending to real estate showed quite a pickup in the first quarter of this year. You know, I don't think we're heading back into bubble territory or anything like that, but I think there are some signs of some pickup in an important market that would be moving in that direction if this reflation objective is being achieved. The second criticism of the negative interest rate policy by the Bank of Japan is this criticism of that it is kind of exerting a very negative impact on the banking system. It's squeezing margins and damaging the banking system. And again, I think this is a little bit, I think we have to be a little bit careful about this argument from a couple of directions. One is just the simple observation that the role of monetary policy is not to help the banks make money. It is to manage the macro economy, to manage aggregate demand, and to achieve the objectives of the central bank. So the fact that if the banks are being squeezed, in and of itself is perhaps irrelevant, is too strong a word, but that's not the main point of issue here. Now, that may sound a little bit too blasé, because monetary policy does work through the banking system, and you need a sound banking system in order to have a sound economy and for monetary policy to work. So it is necessary to consider these arguments. But again, if you think about the way that negative interest rates are working in Japan, it's not as if the Bank of Japan is imposing on the asset side of the banking system's balance sheet a huge negative interest rate. As I said, it's only a relatively small amount portion of the assets. The rest of the asset side of the banking system's balance sheet, those lending rates and therefore the margins are essentially going to be determined in competitive equilibrium. So the idea that somehow the banks are being forced to accept margins which are sort of damaging to the banking system, at some level, sounds a little bit suspect as an argument, because if it's a competitive environment, margins may be squeezed, but they'll be squeezed to the point where the banks are earning a normal rate of economic return. It may not be wonderful profits, but again, that's not the role of the central bank to worry too much about that. So I'm a little bit skeptical at the moment about these arguments that somehow suddenly negative interest rate policy is causing all this damage to the banking system. And of course, there's a quantity. The issue really is going to be the quantity of loans, whether that picks up or not. I think that's the key variable to look at here. Now, my criticisms of negative interest rate policy are a little bit different, really, and at a twofold. The first one is that, as I mentioned before, as an economist, a central bank watcher, you know, I really struggle to explain to people just exactly how these negative interest rates work and, you know, sort of trace through the balance sheet mechanics of this. It's pretty counterintuitive. It's sort of like Alice in Wonderland, stepping through the looking glass. Suddenly you're in a world of negative interest rates. What the heck is that? How does that work? So just the very complexity and counterintuitive nature of this scheme makes it very hard to understand. And by the way, I mentioned before that the Bank of Japan's negative interest rate scheme is very clever. It's, you know, it's a work of art, a work of monetary policy art, but it is also perhaps too complicated. And one of the great things about monetary policy under Governor Kuroda was he came in and really simplified things with QQE. It was a very simple message. It was a very simple framework. Monetary policy under Governor Shirakawa, if you go back to those years, was very complicated. The Bank of Japan was doing a lot of fiddly little things, adding this scheme and that scheme, and it was very hard to keep track of it all. Governor Kuroda sort of simplified 2% inflation target, QQE, expand the monetary base by 60 trillion, now 80 trillion a year, sort of keep it simple. And that's important because communication is very important. Clear communication is very important for the effectiveness of monetary policy. And if what central banks are doing becomes too complicated, that frankly speaking, even experts find it difficult to kind of disentangle, probably you've gone down the wrong rabbit hole. So that's really one of my criticisms, that probably just a little bit too clever for its own good. It also, the fact that the Bank of Japan adopted negative interest rates in January of this year sort of begged the question of why now? Well, partly it was because the Europeans were doing it, so the Bank of Japan had a sort of a model to work off. But remember, the Bank of Japan has been easing monetary policy for about a quarter of a century. And to suddenly, after a quarter of a century, say, aha, we've discovered a new trick, it's called negative interest rates, kind of begs the question of, really? I mean, do you really understand this? So it smacked a little bit of desperation. And that being complicated, smacking a little bit of desperation, again, may have actually undermined the credibility. And again, there seems to be widespread criticism in Japan of negative interest rate policy. Even if that criticism is unfair, nonetheless, you know, that in and of itself undermines the effectiveness of monetary policy. The second criticism that I would sort of have, or reservation perhaps is a better word, that I would have about negative interest rate policy, whether it's the Bank of Japan, whether it's the ECB, wherever it is if you've got to the point where the central bank has hit the zero bound, it's done quantitative easing, and most of these central banks are doing quantitative easing and negative interest rates together, but now has to go into this very unusual territory of negative interest rates, isn't that telling you something about perhaps you've got the wrong policy mix? It's probably telling you that you should be relying more on fiscal policy and perhaps putting less of the burden on monetary policy. That brings me to the final topic, and I'm just running over time a little bit, but have a few more minutes, Anthony, on helicopter money. And I think this discussion of helicopter money, which is actually, I'm not quite sure how big a discussion it is in Japan at the moment, but I was in Europe in April, and I was somewhat surprised how many people were talking about helicopter money around the official policy circles in Europe, at the central banks and other places. It was on everybody's lips. And I think the reason for this interest in helicopter money is coming from the fact that, well, if central banks are going to do negative interest rates, isn't there something else they could do before that? What about this idea of helicopter money? Now, helicopter money was this idea. It's a famous story that's in all the sort of textbooks. Economists love this. Milton Friedman, one of the godfathers of economics, of monetary economics in particular, in his 1969 book, used this idea of helicopter money, which was basically just to make the point that a government or central bank should always be able to create inflation just by dropping money out of the sky, out of the proverbial helicopter. And people would pick that money up, and they would then presumably start to spend it. But in aggregate, you know, that money just passes around the system, passes around from hand to hand. And if the economy is already at full employment, injecting more cash into the system, people will want to reduce their cash holdings. They'll do that by spending the money, but actually, if you're at full employment, you can't produce any more than you can at full employment, and so that impulse will be felt in a rise in the price level. It will be the price level rising, or inflation, that sort of is the equilibrating mechanism to get the system back in equilibrium, so that people are actually just holding that extra cash willingly because the price level has gone up, and that's the new equilibrium. You can also use that helicopter money argument to say, well, if the economy is not at full employment, dropping that helicopter money can then, you know, people will start to spend it, and now the spending, rather than causing the price level to rise, will cause more output to be produced, more employment, and therefore get the economy back to full employment. So that's sort of the idea of helicopter money. The controversy about it is more about not the theoretical aspects of whether it works or not. I think most economists kind of think that it probably would work. The problem is, you know, controversy about how you would actually do this, and how would it actually work given the institutional frameworks that we have. Now, some economists, Ben Bernanke, for example, in a recent blog, and others, have argued that, well, if you really map the Friedman idea of helicopter money into real-world institutions, we have independent central banks, we have treasuries and governments, that really what it is a combination of the government giving a tax cut, giving people more money that way, therefore running a bigger budget deficit, and the central bank simultaneously doing QE, that is essentially buying those bonds, so sort of monetary financing of an increased deficit, which is being generated because the government is giving tax cuts. Now, in balance sheet terms, if you sort of work through the balance sheets, that probably sort of roughly looks like helicopter money. The problem with when you do the balance sheet analysis is, if you read Friedman, he doesn't ever talk about balance sheets. A lot of the monetary economists don't really look at it, the balance sheets, how they're working, which you really have to take notice of in the real world. There's just the helicopter comes down and money falls out of the sky. So it's a little bit difficult to see how it maps into those institutions. But one idea is simply tax cuts financed by quantitative easing. But it does sound like a far cry from sort of helicopter money. And indeed, that's sort of what a lot of people are doing at the moment. But one of the key problems is, and Charlie Bean, the ex-deputy governor of the Bank of England, has made this point quite forcefully, which is, as well as the Friedman helicopter, there's what Charlie Bean calls the Friedman vacuum cleaner, that if the money, the helicopter money, is being created by the government giving tax cuts, what's to stop the government later on from reversing that tax cut and soaking that money up? And if it does, and if that possibility is there under the guise, for example, of fiscal consolidation, theory would tell you actually the helicopter drop is not really going to work. So that's sort of part of the controversy. When you think about it that way, maybe the better way to implement helicopter money, and something that would look, you know, again, would be more simple and more intuitive, would simply be for the central bank, which after all runs the payment system, one of the things it does, to just credit everybody's bank account with a certain amount of money. So that would be pretty much the equivalent of the helicopter. The central bank just says, congratulations, you now have $5,000 or, you know, whatever, you know, 500,000 yen more in your bank account, or if you don't have a bank account, sends you a check or something, whatever. The problem with that is, that sounds awfully like fiscal policy, and central banks are not supposed to do fiscal policy. And most of the central banks, if you look at their legislation, are not written in a way that would be legal for them to do that. So, you know, again, institutional frameworks would need to be changed. I think one of the messages, and I'll start to wind up here, is that when you have these discussions about helicopter money, when you have these discussions also about QE, what we're sort of learnt, I think, is that the lines between monetary and fiscal policy have really become quite blurred after the financial crisis. And the message, the lesson that maybe we should take away from this is that the concept that we had of monetary policies over here, and that's done by independent central banks, and fiscal policies over here, and that's done by the government, and sort of never the twain shall meet. And that's particularly the case in the Eurozone, for example, where the ECB does monetary policy, and there's 19 different governments that does fiscal policy for the Eurozone countries. That structure that we are very sort of familiar with is really, to a certain extent, an artificial structure. It's there for certain reasons, but it's not God-given. It's sort of man-made. So I think what we're observing when we come to this question of have policy makers run out of ammunition, I don't think they've run out of ammunition. Governments can always run more budget deficits. Central banks can keep on buying bonds that governments issue to finance those budget deficits. So I think the argument that they've run out of ammunition is not very valid. But what I think is perhaps more true is that as we proceed further and further down this path, and if the global economy is subject to another series of shocks, such that policymakers have to start to use more and more ammunition, that it will increasingly call into question the kind of frameworks that we've had in the past, and maybe some serious adjustments will have to be made in the whole nature of economic policy frameworks, maybe to get the helicopters off the ground, for example. So let me leave it there, and I very much welcome questions and comments from the audience. Thank you very much.
Certainly plenty of food for thought to digest there. Thank you, Paul. Okay, questions from the working press, please. Do we have questions? Might I quickly ask you a question myself? You haven't talked about the idea of governments becoming, or central banks and governments becoming not lenders of last resort, but spenders of last resort. In other words, the only agency that can get consumption investment moving forward is a government, because it has powers to. But if this does happen, and I think to some extent this is being considered in Japan at the moment, what are the merits and what are the dangers, do you think, of effective monetization of government debt?
So thanks, Anthony. I think one of the big debates that has been out there came to at the end of my talk before, is there's been this sort of excessive reliance on monetary policy and central banks since the financial crisis. If you go back to the financial crisis and just think about that event, that was a major shock to the financial system that plummeted the developed world economy into a major recession. In the US, GDP fell peak to trough, and most of this was in two quarters, 4.2% in the Eurozone, 5.8%, and in Japan, of all places, 9.2%, a drop in real GDP. In other words, this was a sudden loss of aggregate demand. And then the question should have been, okay, how do we restore that aggregate demand as quickly as possible? That's the role of macroeconomic policy. And the question logically should have been, what is the appropriate mix of monetary and fiscal policy? And if you think of, well, what were the reasons for the collapse in aggregate demand? It was because we had, particularly in the US and to a certain extent Europe, less so in Japan obviously, but a credit-fueled housing asset price bubble and overinvestment in housing, et cetera. And now a collapse in housing prices. In the US, for example, housing prices peak to trough went down 34%. The economies of the developed world went into what I like to call a secular deleveraging, And that is an environment in which, just a priori, you would not have expected monetary policy to have worked very well. On the other hand, if you're trying to restore aggregate demand quickly, relatively quickly, so you can do two things. You can either cut interest rates or use monetary policy and make it more attractive for people to borrow. But if people don't want to borrow, they want to deleverage, that's not going to work very well. And that's what we've observed. Doesn't mean you don't do it, but you shouldn't expect it to have very much effect, and certainly not quickly. Or you could say we need to inject government
that we need to inject demand back into the system through government spending. And again, there are two ways to do that. One is tax cuts, but again, if you're deleveraging, the tendency would be to save those tax cuts to help you repair the balance sheet. That may be worth doing, but it's not going to work probably magically. The best way to get demand into the system, again, a priori, logically, would be for the government to directly spend. And that can take two forms, what economists call government consumption, which is basically hiring more people, teachers, postal workers, you know, whoever, scientists, research and development, many ways of doing that, or giving those government investment, so investment into infrastructure, for example. When you look at the data on this, let me just quote the US, for example. Everybody talks about the stimulus, and in the US, stimulus is really a dirty word. It's very unpopular. But if you look at the GDP numbers, there was a little bit of stimulus for about a year or so, but net-net, since the financial crisis in, say, fourth quarter of 2008, the contribution of government spending into the economy in the US has been slightly negative. Not very negative, but slightly negative. Now, in a growing economy, you would expect all sectors to be contributing to growth, the private sector and the government sector. And yet in the US, the government sector net-net has detracted from growth. So that seems really quite extraordinary, that when you have interest rates now very, very low, and you have, so central banks making it very easy for governments to borrow with QE and other policies, that has not really been taken up. So I would be more, Anthony, in the camp of saying the policy mix should have been tilted much more in the direction of spend rather than hope that banks would lend. You also mentioned the sort of monetization. Again, quick 30-second answer there would be to say, you know, context and intent are everything. So obviously, you know, any card-carrying economist would worry about inflation getting out of control. You go back to the Weimar Republic, you go back to the post-war inflation in Japan, more recently the hyperinflation in Zimbabwe. And so there's always concern about central banks printing money and financing deficits. But it's very important to look at, you know, why is the central bank doing that, and what is its intent? If it is doing it because there's a deficiency of aggregate demand and there is a threat of deflation, and a little bit of, call it monetization of government debt, is going to increase demand and is going to put a bit of upward pressure on a falling price level, that's the problem you're actually trying to solve. So I think we should resist the temptation to have sort of knee-jerk reactions to, oh, QE and budget deficits look like monetization, and I'm pre-programmed to think that must be bad, therefore I'm against it. I think that's not the way to go. And I think we need to be more considered about that.
Thank you. Okay, questions about Brexit or about China or... let me just ask you again, if I may. What do you think will happen to the yen in the immediate aftermath of Brexit? I mean, will it rise very significantly if Brexit is approved? Will it collapse if Brexit is not approved?
Well, one thing I've learned not to do is forecast foreign exchange rates. But on the other hand, economists are also trained. We always have to answer a question, so I'll try and walk that fine line. Well, I think the premise of your question, Anthony, was if Brexit were to happen. That was the first part of the question. Now, if we'll find out on Thursday with the Brexit vote. Personally, I think it's. I'd be very surprised if the vote went to in the direction of Brexit, simply because, well, for a number of reasons. But one is simply forget the polls for the moment. I think the polls are not necessarily all that dependable in this context. Maybe the betting odds are a little bit more dependable, but I think they show the Remain in the camp. This Brexit vote is very important, but it is. When you look at what would the British people be getting net-net if they voted to leave the European Union, the cost-benefit analysis and the balance of risks just doesn't feel compelling. Probably the most problematic aspect of the European Union for the countries that are in it are the ones that are in the Eurozone, because they're stuck in a monetary union and they don't have the benefits of fiscal union. And they've actually lost a lot of their macroeconomic policy flexibility. And so you have countries like Greece, which is in very dire straits, but even countries like Italy, which still GDP is more than 8% below the pre-crisis peak level. So a lot of these countries are suffering. But Britain's not, because Britain joined the economic union but didn't join the Eurozone. And in fact, they have a permanent derogation. They never have to join the euro. And they're also not in the Schengen, which is this borderless zone of actually 22 of the 28 EU countries are in the Schengen, but Britain's not one of those. Now, they do have freedom of movement. They have border control, but they have freedom of movement. And there's this whole immigration kind of debate, et cetera, and the sensitivity there. So yes, there would be, you know, some Britain, by leaving the EU, could regain some sovereignty over certain aspects, but they already have a lot of their sovereignty, and by giving up some sovereignty, they get a lot of benefits from being in the EU. So just net-net, it doesn't seem like a compelling proposition. I would add to that, but of course it's a question of, you know, it's a sovereign choice. It's not for anybody to dictate to the British people how they vote. But on the other hand, given that they can either choose the status quo, which they know they're very familiar with, there's not much uncertainty associated with that, or they can take an absolute leap into the unknown, because nobody knows if Britain went down the Brexit path how that process would play out. There are a lot of people out there forecasting dire things to happen. We don't know how dire they would be. There's just, it's racked with uncertainty. So, you know, do you go with the devil you know or the devil you don't? I think that some inherent conservatism at the end of the day will probably prevail, and therefore it will be a fairly safe Remain vote. But your question was, what if? And you know, I think if there was a Brexit, then I think everybody is pretty much agreed that sterling would weaken, and one of the currencies sterling would weaken against for a while would be the yen. If, on the other hand, we get through this uncertainty, and the uncertainty is resolved in the direction of the Remain being the dominant vote, then, you know, then, and, you know, again, you could probably figure that there has been some, as I mentioned in my talk, sort of flight to safety up until now ahead of that vote. I would certainly not be surprised if, in the wake of a Remain vote, you know, the yen weakened a little bit, because that risk premium, or that component of flight to quality, you know, the sort of safety valve is released on that. But don't place any foreign exchange bets on the basis of anything I just said.
I won't.
Okay. If no regular member has a question, can we take a question from associate members? Does anyone have a question? Yes, over here.
Hi. James Menger from Bloomberg News. Just a question about the lowering of the yield curve, you know, from negative rates and just generally more from QE. I mean, there's an argument that by lowering the yield curve so substantially, all that really does is to provide money that goes into zombie companies and allows companies that should be, you know, creatively destroyed or should go out of business to continue to exist and to continue to do business because the cost of capital is so low. And if you look at, say, housing loans in Japan before and after negative rates, they've come down from, I guess the rate was 1.8% to 1.2% or even lower for, you know, fixed rate 10-year, 20-year mortgages. You know, if you can't borrow money at, if the bank won't lend you money at 1.8%, but they will lend you at 1.2% or 1%, it doesn't seem to be you're a particularly good credit risk. Do you think that, you know, the overall benefit has of negative rates, or just more generally QE and lowering the yield curve, has been to provide capital to people and companies that are not good credit risk, that are not making good investments, that are not generating, you know, good dynamic growth?
Yeah, thanks, James. That's a you know, a complicated question. I'm a little bit, you know, I've lived in Japan a long time, and there was always the zombie argument, the zombie company argument here as well. You sort of heard that in the wake of the policy responses in 2008. I sometimes feel a little bit, this may be unfair, but I feel sometimes that people who sort of make those arguments often actually are already predisposed against QE, and they're sort of looking for arguments and mobilizing them. So I sort of start my perspective on that from a little bit of a skeptical vantage point that, you know, is this argument being made because basically the conclusion is we want to marshal arguments against QE because we don't like QE or we don't like zero interest rate policies. But to get to the substance of the question, I tend to think that, I mean, I think there is a question, as we talked about before, of, you know, if you have a deficiency of aggregate demand, what is the best way of getting rid of that deficiency, that is, getting back to full employment? Is it monetary policy or is it fiscal policy? And maybe, you know, it is the case in certain environments, such as we've had, that there is more risk of perpetuating so-called zombie companies if you rely too much on monetary policy rather than fiscal policy. So fiscal policy might get you back to full employment in a way that doesn't lower interest rates to the point where you have these zombie companies being kind of surviving. But, you know, beyond that, my instincts really is to say that I don't really think it's the job, if we just focus on monetary policy here for the moment, it's sort of the job of monetary policy to try to second guess those issues too much. That, you know, the role of monetary policy, again, is sort of in some sense to lift all boats and get the economy back to full employment. So everybody, you know, who wants a job has got a job. And in some sense, if that means that some of these zombie companies are also sort of floated and those zombie companies are actually employing people, you know, that's kind of good. Those people are in the workforce, they're earning money. Now, the counter to that would be to say, yeah, but there's been a sort of a misallocation of capital. You could have been at a different full employment equilibrium where you had more dynamic companies, right? But again, I just don't think it's the role of monetary policy somehow to be, you know, managing both the overall level of aggregate demand and the distribution of that aggregate demand. If the concern is about zombie companies per se, then I think you kind of need structural policies and other policies that get at, in some sense, the underlying causes of why you have zombie companies to begin with. So that would be, I'm a little bit net, cut a long story short, a little bit skeptical of concerns about zombie companies driving macroeconomic policy per se. I think it probably gets you to the wrong place. But it's a complicated argument. Yeah, we've got some hands now.
My name is Khalil. I'm Ambassador of Bahrain. Every time I listen to you, I get very impressed by your analysis. You know, 20th century, suddenly there was a lot of science. And we trusted a lot of this science. And if scientists talk, it's like God. We immediately believe him. 21st century, things are changing. There's so much knowledge. There's so much information. There's so much confusion. At the same time, globalization and technology is changing the world. Now, my question become very more clear if you talk about economics. You know, we see the more we discuss economics, the more we are confused. Okay, my question to you, are we going to reinvent economics for the third millennium that we can maybe able to manage our challenges? Thank you, sir.
Oh, thank you, Ambassador. That's a very big kind of question. Let me answer it and take it in the following way. I think that there is a lot of soul searching going on in the economics profession. And I don't think the economists, frankly speaking, you know, have been the most humble of people. And you know, even since the financial crisis, I think economists have been a little bit slow to kind of reflect on their own toolkit and discipline. So I think you are seeing. I have to say, I used to be an academic. I left academia in 1995, but I've always sort of, you know, kind of felt I'm a spiritual sort of academic card carrier. But somewhat disappointed when I check in with my academic colleagues from time to time of, you know, the state of the academia in terms of, you know, are you really reinterrogating your policy frameworks and a lot of your basic belief systems? And that process has been quite slow, I think, in economics. There has been some Institute of New Economic Thinking, for example, which was bankrolled by George Soros, and there's been different initiatives like that, but I think by and large economists have been a little bit slow. So far we haven't seen, if you go back to the 1930s and back to the 20s, the Great Crash and then the Great Depression, that brought forth a revolution in economics in the form of John Maynard Keynes. We haven't seen Keynes come forward since this financial crisis. And interestingly though, but there are some debates. There's this debate, for example, on secular stagnation. And a very interesting thing there is, of course, this is something that Larry Summers has really kicked off. He's the main proponent. Back in November 2013, he kicked off with a speech. But the secular stagnation, so this is the idea that essentially, it's a technical idea actually, that the natural rate of interest may be negative. That is, the real rate of interest that equates the supply of savings with the demand for savings, partly because of changes in technology, partly because of GDP, we're moving into an information economy. People talk about the fourth industrial revolution, a knowledge economy, an app economy. That investment these days increasingly is people sitting in front of a computer writing code. So capital investment is becoming less and less capital intensive. There's all sorts of arguments that maybe we're stuck permanently, maybe stagnation's not the right word, but we're stuck in a situation where interest rates are going to be very, very low. And so the whole of, sort of relates to the zombie question to a certain extent. A lot of the premises that our economic system was based on the natural rate of interest is, maybe, 2.5, 3, 4% or something. But what if it's minus 0.5% or zero? So there is a debate that is starting up in economics around those issues. I think there's a long way to go. Interestingly, the FOMC meeting last week, Wednesday, I guess it was, Wednesday or Thursday, which produced a few surprises. Nobody was expecting the Fed to raise interest rates, but what came out of that meeting was essentially a message from the Fed that they are rethinking the long-term neutral rate of the federal funds rate, which is not another way of saying that the long-run natural rate of interest. And there's seems to be an active debate going on in the FOMC about this issue as well, and more people thinking maybe we don't need to raise interest rates for quite a long time. So, I think very early days in terms of economics kind of reinventing itself, but I think we're heading in that direction.
Are you prepared to go over Matthew next?
Yeah.
Süddeutsche Zeitung, Neidhardt. Good to see you again. Zero interest rates is the mildest form of financial repression, and Mr. and Mrs. Watanabe seem to understand that and go more into gold, for example. Now, Japan has very, very little chance to grow substantially, to grow its economy substantially. When I look back at Weimar, at the Soviet Union, which I experienced, financial repression ended in freezing saving accounts, in cutting two zeros. And it looks like, you said, the Bank of Japan has a long way to go to do more. But it will end up in more financial repression, I assume. Or do you use that famous phrase of economists, this time it's different?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think some of these questions are really, frankly speaking, very open ones. We probably need to debate a lot more. I don't have all the answers. But, financial repression is usually used in the in the sense of developing economies. China would be a good example, for example, where the financial system, where basically households and companies don't have freedom to hold a range of assets. The financial system doesn't have the ability to create all kinds of assets. The financial household sector is not able to invest in a range of assets domestically and internationally, and essentially the savings are all kind of mobilized into the banking system and directed into certain sectors. That would be the classic financial repression. And I think your question is interesting, and many people sort of say, well, zero interest rates is sort of, okay, people are still free to do whatever they like, but, the interest rate is zero, so a lot of their their kind of choices have effectively been cut off. But I think the kind of financial repression that, if you're going to call this world we're in now financial repression, I think we have to probably find a different term to distinguish it from that kind of financial repression where essentially the government is using administrative controls to repress people. But maybe where we're sort of getting to with all of this is sort of reinterrogating the whole concept of money. You know, where does money come from in the first place? And in the economies that we live in, really money comes from two places. I mean, other than Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies and things like that. But fundamentally, in the modern society, money is essentially comes from two places. One is it comes from the government. Governments run budget deficits. They create money, which is usually turned into government bonds. But QE is turning those government bonds back into central bank money. And also the banking system creates money. Every time a bank lends to a borrower, it's creating a deposit, and that deposit is money. But that banking system, the credit creation through the banking system itself, is connected very much to the sovereign, to the central bank. The central bank is the banker to the banking system. So, you know, if anybody takes money out of the bank, what they're now doing is holding a liability of the central bank. And the common thing that is associated with money, whether it's created by the government or whether it's created by the banking system, is it's an asset for the private sector that can be used to extinguish tax liabilities. So behind all of this, the ability of governments to tax the public creates a demand for government liabilities, which that is money, which can be used to extinguish tax liabilities. So what I'm grappling for here is this idea that ultimately there is a sense that the government, because it controls money at the end of the day and has that power to tax, at the end of the day, when it comes to money, in some shape or form, is able to call the shots. And that may be one of the reasons that these, you know, the cryptocurrency kind of movement, it's very anarchistic in a way. People who want to be able to create money that is not under the control of governments, and maybe they're trying to get out of a world where there's some sort of implicit financial repression. But you raised some very interesting issues.
Can we run it to 145? Is that okay?
Yeah, sure.
Stefano, is it your working press?
Thank you. I'm Stefano Carre for the Italian Economic Daily. I found interesting what the International Monetary Fund 2 days ago suggested to Japan. They came for the Article 4, the periodic missions. One of the suggestions was to try to force companies to raise salaries. I mean, it was the International Monetary Fund to say that. I mean, to try to in some way give a big incentive to profitable companies to raise salaries. So what do you think of this suggestion? Because, I mean, one idea probably is that the top manager, top executive, have no incentive to raise salaries because it's raising fixed costs. And also in Japan, recently, part of their compensation is linked to the growing part of their compensation of managers is linked to financial performances. So if they have excess cash in the company, they prefer to do buybacks of shares or raise dividends, but not raising the consumption power of the consumers in some way. Mm. Thanks.
Thanks, Stefano. I haven't read that Article 4 report yet, but the way I would so it's interesting, very interesting. The IMF is suggesting that. I think my answer to that would be to really make the following observation, which is if you go back to what the Bank of Japan is trying to achieve. So we had a situation for 15, 20 years where, say, inflation was around about -0.5% to 1%, let's say, and the Bank of Japan is trying to get that to 2%. What you can think of that the problem there is that it's like what economists call a coordination game. That is, you can think in terms of, again, I hate using fancy jargon, but multiple equilibria. Economists like the concept of multiple equilibria, which is the idea that you can have, the economy can be in, call it a certain configuration. Let's call it a configuration where there's, you know, say 1% deflation, so wages are not going up very much, maybe they're just flat, reflecting a little bit of productivity growth, and so real wages are going up, say 1%, something like that. But you could have another configuration where, you know, inflation is 2% and productivity growth is 1% and nominal wages are going up at 3%, roughly. In real terms, both of those configurations are the same. Real wages are still going up at the same rate. But they're stuck in different configurations. One's a mild deflationary configuration, the other is a mild inflationary configuration. And what Mr. Kuroda has been trying to do, and the government, under Abenomics, is move the Japanese economy from one configuration to the other. But the problem is, how do you get there? It's really a coordination game where the best way to get there is for everybody to sort of agree that that's where they're going and everybody to change their behavior kind of all at once. So that would be a world, for example, where all the corporate managers in Japan that you talked about said, well, Bank of Japan is aiming for 2% inflation. The government is aiming for 2% inflation. Why should I second guess that? I'm going to give wage hikes. If they all do that, then you'll get 2% inflation, and actually real wages won't have gone up very much. But then you say, well, hold on a minute. Why should everybody believe that, and why should everybody act like that? What if you're skeptical? And let's face it, you know, these are controversial issues, and there's many reasons to be skeptical. You know, so the average corporate manager says, well, you know, I don't think there's going to be 2% inflation. Inflation last year was zero. I think I'm going to factor in maybe zero to continue. Therefore, I'm not. Why would I give a 2% or a 3% wage hike? That would be actually, as you mentioned, Stefano, my shareholders might start complaining about that. Mr. Abe and Mr. Kuroda might be happy, but my shareholders would be very unhappy. So I think while it's great for the IMF to make this point, I'm not sure that that many people are going to heed the clarion call. So I think that probably the way this is, and I think that's one of the reasons why it's been so difficult so far for the Bank of Japan to achieve its target. But if I was in Mr. Kuroda's shoes, okay, you know, Japan does have the Shunto, the spring offensive, that does have a somewhat corporatist system. It has the Council on Economic and Fiscal Policy, where you have corporate interests, you have the Bank of Japan, you have the government represented. So there is a bit of a framework for trying to get that kind of coordinated approach. And I think that has been actually an explicit element of Abenomics. But having said all of that, if I'm Mr. Kuroda and I'm thinking, how do I achieve my objective? I think I would not be relying on, you know, the good offices of, you know, corporate management in Japan. I would be using, in some sense, the brute force of monetary policy. That is, you almost have to change that equilibrium by almost brute force, rather than trying to kind of, you know, appeal to people's best instincts. And that's, I think, you know, what is kind of going on. But it's a bit of chicken and egg issue. You can't get prices, you can't get inflation of 2% unless you get wages going up, but you really are not going to get wages going up unless there's evidence that prices are going up. So when I say brute force, it's sort of that the Bank of Japan almost has to just keep going, keep going, keep going, and eventually, look, the unemployment rate in Japan is 3.2%. Job offers to applicants are at the highest level since 1992. The underlying rate of inflation is not that bad. If you look at the core measure, which strips out fresh food and energy, it's plus 0.9. It's not the 2% yet, but it did get to 1.3% a few months ago. So, you know, the macroeconomic conditions are such, we think that growth in Japan is going to be above potential for the next couple of years. This year, maybe 0.7, next year, 1%. If you do get growth like that, and the labor market keeps tightening, you will start to get some inflationary pressures coming through. And it's when the corporate sector see that, that they say, well, now it's in my best interests to give wage hikes, because, you know, otherwise I'm going to be squeezing my workforce, and that's not in my best interests either.
All right.
think we really have to cut it off there. thank you very much indeed for giving us a very stimulating talk. You really should come once a month and give us a series of lectures, I think. Let me give you, as is the custom here, a one-year honorary membership, and let me confess that I spilled a glass of water all over it, so I hope it's still in good condition. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much.